Well, good morning, Deerfield Road campus. I love the time to greet. I wish it could go on for 20 minutes as an extrovert, and all the introverts are like, thank you, Lord, no, it's over. It's good to be in God's house. As you know, I'm from the Cathedral campus, and it gives me great joy to be able to come and minister the Word of God today. But you didn't come to hear from me. You came to hear from the Lord. And so I would ask you to bow your heads with me just one brief moment as we ask the Lord Jesus to go before us. Lord, thank you so much for this day, a day that we pause and we remember that you are the great Father. You've never disappointed us. We are your children, and I pray, Lord, that you would be with us as we go into the Word. I pray that you would speak to each and every one of us. First and foremost, I pray for forgiveness of sin in my life that would keep the communication of this word from going forth with authority. Ask for forgiveness, Lord, as I share with God's people. And I pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So I'm a little jealous of Pastor Jason on sabbatical, you know, spending time with the family and enjoying just time with the Lord. Just touched base with him briefly this week, and he is missing you all. And I told him, I said, they're not missing you, Jason, at all. They're just moving right on. No, he is definitely doing well, and just wanted to make sure to send greetings to each and every one of you. As we get started today, something that's a little different for us as a church family, that we're really committing some time to be able to celebrate our fathers during this service and this sermon. So one of the things that I wanted to do, I don't want to embarrass anyone, not call anyone forward, but if you are a father, you're a dad, can you just stand where you are? We want to just acknowledge you and say thank you so much for all that you do. Oh, come on, y'all could do better than that. These are the men who are fathers in our church. Amen. Some of you saw the fun that so many of us had at Act Like Men last weekend. And for me, as I think about Father's Day, I want to pause and say thank you to each and every one of you men. Some of you are future fathers, and some of you maybe are here under the sound of my voice, and Father's Day is maybe a challenging day. See, everybody doesn't have the story that my dad is awesome. Everybody doesn't come from the Leave It to Beaver family where dad seemingly was perfect and could fix everything and treated mom with utmost respect and loved the children and listened to them. For some of us, we had E! True Hollywood families where our fathers were there, but we don't have a lot of stories that maybe we want to share about that. And if that's you, I want to say thank you for coming to church today. I want you to know that God, your heavenly Father, is perfect. He didn't get it wrong, and he knew exactly the family that you would be in. It wasn't a mistake that you landed where you did. And so if that's your story, I want to say thank you so much for having faithfulness and heeding God's voice and coming to him. I have a father. His name is Ed Sr., and I'm Ed Jr., and I have two brothers and three sisters. I'm the oldest out of six. And my dad, Ed, yes, I know, thank you for praying for my dad. My dad and my late mother are originally from Mississippi, and my dad was in college when he met my mother at Mississippi Valley State. And promptly dropped out and moved to Iowa, Des Moines, Iowa, where they raised these amazing six kids. And the pictures that you see are from my brother's wedding a little over a year ago. I think about the things that my dad taught me. And this morning, he texted me and he said, I just want you to know that I'm praying for you and I'm so glad of the man that you've become. Have a great day in worship. He's probably preaching somewhere this morning as well. But when you hear the words like that, it just encourages you as a man to know that there's a mantle on your life. There's an expectation that God has for every person who is a father. And I think that men are under assault in our culture today. Yes, there's privilege that we have as men. There are opportunities that we have as men that we need to steward. But there's a reality that biblical manhood is under assault today at every corner. And today, I want to put a stake in the ground by faith to acknowledge, to encourage, and to exhort every man that's here and every woman that's here of how we can choose wisely. And so the text today is Joshua chapter 24. I want to ask you to run with me to the Bible. Grab your Bibles or grab your neighbor's Bible. Make sure that you're looking at God's word this morning as we look at the topic, Fathers Choose This Day. Fathers Choose This Day. We're going to start at the 14th verse of chapter 24. But it's important, before we get into the text today, to understand a few things about what is happening in Joshua chapter 24. Obviously, there are 13 verses that are before our text, and I'm just going to briefly summarize what actually is taking place. God, through Joshua, is beginning in love to open up a can. He's going to let God's people know what he's done on their behalf. If you want a little background, as you go through this week, you should go to Joshua chapter 22 and look at the amazing tension that's going on. Chapter 22 talks about some things that I'm going to talk about in a little bit, is the challenge of idolatry. The challenge that God's people continually looked at and for other substitutes that were not God. But in the first 13 verses, I love that Joshua just goes through, and the personal pronoun I is used 18 times by God. And it's interesting that so many times we think of saying the word I as being conceited or pompous or full of ourselves. But in this case, God is simply stating what he's done on behalf of the people. It's I who brought you out of Egypt. It's I who has provided for you. It's I who have provided the leaders that you have. I've done it. Reminds me of a retirement talk that Michael Jordan gave that some of you may be familiar with. And Michael Jordan was giving the talk, and he was talking about one of the assistant coaches and Tex Winter for the Chicago Bulls back in the days when they were good and actually won basketball games. And Tex Winter went up to Michael Jordan after one of the games that he didn't follow directions and didn't follow the play and took the last shot, and they won. And Tex, in the locker room after everyone left, came up to Michael and said, Michael, you need to understand there's no I in team. And Michael shot back at him, there is I in win. And Tex shook his head and just left the locker room. Says, Michael's going to be Michael. This is, in a sense, the God moment where God is saying, I am who I am. I don't ask for permission. I don't need your authority. In fact, there's nothing that you've done as the children of Israel to deserve my goodness, my favor, and my grace. I did it. And I did it because I chose you. Look at verse 13 real quick before we get into the text. I gave you a land on which you have not labored, and cities that you had not built, and you dwell in them. You eat the fruit of the vineyards and olive orchards that you did not plant. God just making it very clear, everything that you have is because I provided it. Do we live our lives in that way? Do we understand that everything that we have as people, everything that we have in this church, everything that we have in our lives is because of the grace of God. And because of that, we can go to the text and lean into what God has to say to each and every one of us through Joshua. So let's go to the Word, and I'm going to read starting at the 14th verse. I'm using the ESV version for those that are following along. "Now therefore fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in faithfulness. Put away the gods that your fathers served beyond the river and in Egypt, and serve the Lord. And if it is evil in your eyes to serve the Lord, choose this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your fathers served in the region beyond the river, or the gods of the Amorites in those lands you dwell." And then he says this that so many of us have heard, buried in chapter 24. "But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." He continues, "The people answered, 'Far be it from us that we should forsake the Lord to serve other gods. For it is the Lord our God who brought us and our fathers up from the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery, and who did those great signs in our sight and preserved us in all the way that we went and among all the peoples through whom we passed. And the Lord drove out before us all the peoples, the Amorites who lived in the land. Therefore, we will also serve the Lord, for he is our God.'" But then the text turns and Joshua says this, "You are not able to serve the Lord, for he is a holy God. He is a jealous God. He will not forgive your transgressions or your sins. If you forsake the Lord and serve foreign gods, then he will turn and do you harm and consume you after having done you good." And the people said to Joshua, "No, but we will serve the Lord." And then Joshua said to the people a fourth time, "You are witnesses against yourselves, and you yourself have chosen the Lord to serve him." And they said, "We are witnesses." And he said, "Then put away the foreign gods that are among you and incline your heart to the Lord, the God of Israel." And the people said to Joshua, "The Lord our God we will serve, and his voice we will obey." So Joshua made a covenant with the people that day and put in place statutes and rules for them at Shechem. And Joshua wrote these words in the book of the law of God. And he took a large stone and he set it up there under the terebinth, which is a tree, that was by the sanctuary of the Lord. And Joshua said to the people, "Behold, this stone shall be a witness against us, for it has heard all the words of the Lord that he spoke to us. Therefore, it shall be a witness against you, lest you deal falsely with your God." So Joshua sent the people away, every man to his inheritance. May the Lord have a blessing to the reading of his word. There's an interesting dialogue that is going on that Joshua has called all of God's people together, and he's sharing these words. And the first thing I want to share with you today, as you are taking notes, is choose to serve. Choose to serve. In verses 14 and 15, as we look a little closer at the text, we find out that there are really two stipulations that God has for his people. God is amazingly clear in his ordinances to the people. Yes, there were many, many laws that they had in the Old Testament, but it was very clear that there were two things that God wanted them to know. The first thing is this: I want you to fear me. I want you to fear me. I want you to fear who I am. I want you to fear the reality of who I am before you. And the second thing is, I want you to serve me. Really clear: fear me and serve me. And the covenant that they had strictly forbade them having other gods. In a little bit, I'm going to talk about how serious this is. But I want to ask ask you today, especially for my brothers that are in the house, who will you choose to serve? I love the proclamation. It began widely, but it became quite personal, that he wanted them to serve them in sincerity and faithfulness and put away the other gods that they had that went before them. Why were these other gods so significant? Well, there were idols that they had from the land of Ur. And there were also other idols that they had. And the idols were interesting. Idols can't talk to you. Idols can't do anything. They're these carved images that they gave their loyalty and their worship to, at the same time trying to hold on to the confession of Yahweh, the true God. And before we get a little too righteous and look at God's people and say, how could they do that? Is that not our testimony and our story at times? Is it not our story that sometimes we choose God when we want to, but we have these little gods, small g, that are in our lives that cause tremendous anxiety and tension because we try to follow them at the same time trying to follow God? The little problem about that is that God doesn't allow that. He doesn't even like that. In fact, in a little bit, we'll find out how serious that he is about taking and allowing anything to take his place. But Joshua made his position quite clear in verse 15. It's interesting. People like to hashtag this and put it on social media and just hype it up and put it on t-shirts. Choose this day whom you'll serve, people. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. I love the declaration that he puts down at the end of his life that is confirmation of what he's done. Because see, this passage is toward the end. He's going to die, we later find out, and he was 110 years old. And yet, he had the foresight to declare before the people, you can do what you want to do, and you can do what you want to do. But in our house, in my house, we are going to serve the Lord. Have you ever had a moment like that in your life? A moment where you had to draw the line in the sand and you decided that it is today that I'm going to say yes to what God has for me. And I'm not going to take imitation. I'm so glad he didn't stop just at choosing to serve, but the second point today that I want to share with you in verses 16 through 18 is consider the reason. Consider the reason why that you make that choice. The people of God responded with great enthusiasm. And this, if you're reading the passage, may cause you to ask, why did Joshua respond the way that he did? God's people said in verse 16 through 18 that far be it that we should forsake the Lord. Far be it that we would follow any of these other gods, because God is the one that brought us up from Egypt. God's the one who's provided manna for us when we could. God is the one who's done it. So you need to understand, Joshua, we're going to serve the Lord. We're going to follow you. We're going to follow leadership as you have proclaimed that this is what we should do. There's a statement that I wrote down in my study that I just want to leave with you, that frequent reflection brings accurate revelation. Frequent reflection brings accurate revelation. They reflected on what God had done and saw that the Lord had drove out their enemies in front of them. They saw that God is actually in control of everything. I think one of the most challenging things for me as a believer, and maybe it is for you, is that we live in a culture where we just move so fast from the one thing to the next. And the reality is we move so fast that we don't understand what God's just done. We as a church have committed this summer to slow down and just be in relationship with one another. Why? Because we had gotten into a habit that we did something and we move right on. We do something, we move right on. We just have act like men, let's move right on. And we're saying, no, slow down. Let's reflect on what God has done. Let's reflect and give thanks for the 30 young men who took the act like men pledge to be more godly men. Let's pause and think about the people who have come to Christ and who have started and said, I'm going to try to do this in my own house. How can we stop and pause and reflect and give God thanks for his goodness? Amen? And I think that the people heard Joshua and they said, we will follow. But listen to how Joshua responds. This is the part of my study that was challenging this week. And I want to ask this question to you. Have you ever made a commitment that you later realized that you would struggle to keep? Just by a show of hands, have you ever made a commitment? Thank you. I mean, it's just awesome. All the truth tellers in the room. The five of you that didn't raise your hand, we know that you're lying. But the reality is this. I've made commitments at times in my life, and I meant full well to keep them. And then looked up and saw that I didn't do it. To be honest, it's the death knell as a pastor. You tell God's people you're going to do something, and you don't follow through. They may not say it to your face, but it's just a little check, integrity check. He's a good guy. He's funny. He's gregarious. He doesn't follow through. He doesn't do what he says. There's nothing more disappointing than losing trust because you don't follow through with the commitment that you've made. I struggled with this in the area of my own fatherhood and in my life, and I struggle with the reality and the tension of saying yes to good things and not saying yes to the best things. So a few years ago, I took a course with Michael Hyatt, just a great productivity guy. And I just really started to realize that who I am as a person, I'm one of those guys, I want to say yes to everything. Anybody else like me? Yeah. Just my heart is just, Pastor Ed, can you come over? Yes. Can you come and visit our, yes. Can you go golfing with me? Absolutely. That will always be a yes. The Lord would want me to do that. But there's things in my life that I need to say no to so that I can actually begin to say yes to the right things. Sometimes your ambition may actually exceed your current capacity. For some of us, our ambition exceeds our current capacity. The fact is that that is not a problem. The fact is it's a problem if you don't realize it. And Joshua knew in this moment that God's people were making a commitment that he questioned whether or not they understood what they were saying. And he wanted them to do this. Your third point in your outline is he wanted them to count the cost. I need you to count the cost of what you're saying. You guys said that you're not going to have any other gods before Yahweh, but do you understand what that means? Do you know what you're saying? Look at what he says in verses 19 through 24. The dialogue heats up, and Joshua turns it up a notch. He says to the people, you're not able to serve the Lord, for he is a holy God. He is a jealous God. He will not forgive your transgressions or your sins. If you forsake the Lord and serve foreign gods, then he will turn and do harm and consume you after having done you good. Does that feel weighty? How is this God, who is all loving, all merciful, how is God saying that he won't forgive? How could God be jealous, Pastor Ed? Isn't that a bad thing that God would be jealous? I didn't think that was a good thing. How is it that God could not forgive the sins of man? Well, thank you, Deerfield Road. Those are three great questions that I intend to answer right now. And there's a slide that's up that I want to show you, A and B, take you back to a little bit of logic. And I want to show you a theological argument that Joshua is building. A, he's a holy God, and he's a jealous God. He stated that he's holy, he's jealous. And then the second A is, he will turn and bring disaster on you and make an end of you. This is a fact. This is a guarantee. Take it home to the bank. This is what God is going to do if B happens. And B is the important thing to see and to look at. He will not forgive your rebellion and your sins. If you forsake the Lord and serve foreign gods, he will not forgive. Why is that important to us? It's important because God's wrath and God's jealousy is reserved for one thing and one thing only in the Bible. It's his response to idolatry. God is quite serious about his glory, and he won't share it with anyone or anything. He's declaring through his son Joshua that I, as your God, will not permit you to use me. For the ladies that are married in the house, you would relate to this very well, that your husband, you want to be faithful to you. Amen, ladies? That was kind of weak, ladies. Let me just say that in. You would want your husbands to be faithful to you. Amen, ladies? All right. And guys, we would want our wives to be faithful to us. Amen? So look at that, just the heartiness of the men. Amen. Amen. And see, God is the same way, and that's the reason why he often talks about marriage as an example of the covenant, is that I am committed to you, and I don't want you to cheat on me. I'm so serious about cheating on you that I'm going to tell you a number of things that just to make sure that you understand that jealousy is actually an incredible, encouraging fact about God. The fact that he's jealous for us who are his children. I want you to write down two scriptures, and I'm going to read a couple, but I want to write just two quick scriptures. Deuteronomy, and it's chapter 12, verse 16. There's another passage that I want you to write down, Exodus chapter 34, verse 14. And I want you to just listen to a couple things that God showed me through his word. The fact that jealousy is something that he takes very, very seriously. Exodus 34 and 14. I'm going to read that one first. And as you listen to these words, I want you to hear the heart of God. For you shall worship no other God, for the Lord, whose name is jealous, is a jealous God. Exodus 34:14 actually says that God's name is synonymous with he's jealous. Why would he be so jealous? Isaiah 42 and 8 is another scripture that you should write down. Isaiah 42 and 8. And Isaiah 48, chapter 11. These are important verses because we find out that God is serious about not only the fact that he's holy, that he's jealous. He wants us all to know that grace is never cheap. Grace is never cheap. After all, he gave his son who died for us. He gave his son who paid the ransom for us. He loves us. And then I think the thing that I've been grappling with in my life and in the life of people that I serve, and I want you to lean in and hear this part because I can't say this with more veracity. And so I want to be very clear. In my ministry, as I talk with people and they come and see me, men, sin has a devastating effect on our lives. It's interesting, there's times in my life where I thought it was private sin. Nobody really knew about it. The funny thing happens, you get married. I have the joy of my life, Marcia, and three kids that are with me today. And this last Monday, we celebrated 24 years of marriage. Isn't that awesome? 24 years of marriage. I really appreciate that. Applause is really for Marcia. I know that praise God for her surviving those 24 years. But the reality is sin has a tremendous cost. And while God loves us and while his grace is sufficient, for some of us, we can understand that there's decisions that we've made in our lives that we've had to pay for because God is righteous. And he's jealous. And he can't allow sin to go unpunished. God's opposed to anything and anyone who will challenge his sovereignty. And what Joshua was doing is he wanted them to understand, I heard what happened and what came from your lips, but I want you to understand what's in your heart. That you have to stop playing with other gods and serve the Lord. So what was he wanting them to do? And the last point is he wanted them to count the cost to lead. And counting the cost leads to eliminating spiritual drift in our lives. Counting the cost causes us to pause. It keeps us from drifting so that we can understand what really God is doing in our lives. I want to ask you this question today. What would your life look like if you directed it instead of drifting through it? What would your life look like today if you actually directed it instead of drifting through it? Have you ever been in times in your life where you just kind of wake up and you realize, you're like, what's going on? I'm just kind of going through the motions. I'm getting up. I'm going to work. I'm doing the things that I'm supposed to do. I'm just kind of surviving. I'm just kind of there. It's not really I'm flourishing and I'm not really failing. I'm just here. And I think too many people in our world think that we don't have the ability to influence our lives because, after all, God has given each and every one of us a gift, and Joshua knew this gift. He's given us the gift of agency. He's giving us the gift of agency. What is agency? Agency is the ability or the power to affect the future. But amazingly, so many people think that we don't have that. We have the ability through the power of Jesus Christ to change our destiny and our future. And God, through our Son, Joshua, is trying to help us understand how we can do that. This week, there was an example of this in our culture. John Stewart, pretty funny man, comedian, don't know about his relationship with Jesus Christ, but John Stewart is quite passionate about first responders and the victims of 9/11. How many of you saw the story about John, what he did this last week? Amazing. How can one person make a difference? Have you heard people say, I can't make a difference? It's just me.
Well, John went to Congress where he was going to speak on behalf of 9/11 first responders, and nobody decided to show up for the hearing. He's speaking to empty seats and a few congressmen. And then with passion, he shared from his heart about how our country has not done what it should do in honoring and helping take care of people who fought for our country. And within hours, millions of people had seen his rant in Congress that led to legislation being drafted up. And people were going to be cared for and taken care of. Why? Because one person understood that he had agency and could use it for the benefit of mankind. What about us? There are four elements of agency that we have that as men today in particular I want us to hone in on. That the first thing is intention. That it means that we can set our minds to a particular outcome and we can work with others to achieve that. But the second thing is that we also have forethought. The fact that by visualizing the future, we can govern our behavior by the present and give purpose and meaning to our actions. But it's not just that there's intention and forethought. The third thing is action. And this is where many of us get stalled, is that we have to take action. You have to do something. Beyond intention and forethought, we have the action to act to our plans and to stay motivated. And then the last one that I've been working on in my life is self-reflection. How do I pause and think about what God is doing in my life and what people are saying to me and what I'm learning? Over the last 6 months, I have become a better pastor because I pause to listen more than respond. I pause to understand versus being understood. And I believe it's important to understand agency because it leads us to our last point of confirming our commitment. Confirming your commitment. Look at what Joshua says. After hearing God's people, they've said again, we're going to serve God. We heard you. We're with you. We're going to serve the Lord. We're going to go forward. We're with you. And then he does what every great leader does. He does what every great father does, is that he does something to put it into action. Look at verse 25 through 28 as I close. So Joshua made a covenant with the people that day. He put statutes and rules before them at Shechem. And Joshua wrote these words in the book of the law. And he took a large stone and he set it up under the terebinth that was by the sanctuary of the Lord. And he said that this stone would be a witness against us. For it has heard all the words of the Lord that he spoke to us. Therefore, it shall be a witness against you, lest you falsely with your God, that you deal falsely with your God. So Joshua sent the people away, every man to his inheritance. I want you to jump down to verses 32 and 33. And for the bones of Joseph, which the people of Israel brought up from Egypt, they buried them at Shechem in the place of the land that Jacob brought from their sons for 100 pieces of money. It became an inheritance of the descendants of Joseph. And what I love is that the Bible says that the next generation after Joshua served the Lord. For us today, as I close, I want to ask the question, what are the gods that you struggle to let go of in your life? We look at God's people and we say, how could they possibly follow these small gods? But the question that we have today for us is, how can we make the choice today to follow God and to choose wisely? I want to pray a blessing over every man that's in this place today. And ladies, don't worry, I'm going to bless you as well. But I want to invite every man under the sound of my voice to stand up just for a moment as I pray a blessing over each and every one of you. Why do I have you stand? I have you stand because I love you and God loves you. And the fact is that God today wants you to take a step toward being the man that he's called you to be. For many men that act like men, they took an oath, a pledge that we've written. It's not just words. It's something that we're seeking to live out in our homes and in our jobs and in our lives. And I want to pray this over each and every one of you men. Even if you didn't have a chance to go to act like men, I want to pray it over you. I want to pray that God would allow you to be the man that he's called you to be. Let's pray. God is my authority. Jesus Christ is my Lord. His Holy Spirit is my guide. And the Bible is my blueprint. I will seek with my whole heart to act like a man. I'm not a woman, I am a man. I'm not an animal, I am a man. I'm not a child, I am a man. I embrace the responsibility to be God's man. And when I fall, I will run to Christ. When I struggle, I will lean on my brothers. At all times, I will live in community with other Christians. And I will lead my future family to do the same. Amen? 1 Timothy 4:12. I will let no one despise me for my youth, but set the believers an example in speech and in conduct, in love and in faith and in purity. Men, look at me. Today, God is calling you to a higher place. To be the men that he's called and commissioned you to be. To live by faith and humility and grace as you love your families. For some of you, as you love your wives. And for some of you, as he prepares you for what he has in your life. God loves you. And I don't want you ever to ever forget about it. Ladies, thank you so much for standing with us and praying for us. And enduring with us. We love you and we thank you. And for the women who are here who've been hurt by men who have not been the men who they've called you to be, I stand and say, I'm sorry. And I ask for your forgiveness on behalf of those men. Because we have great joy. We have great liberty to stand and love you the way that God has called us to love you. Amen. Men, you may be seated. We thank you so much for your word today, God. We thank you that we can choose this day to be the fathers that you've called us to be. So God, as we worship you as a response, we ask for you and your grace to shadow over us, to shower us, Lord Jesus, with your patience, to shower us, Lord Jesus, with your persistence, to be the men that you've called us to be. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand and worship the Lord Jesus as we close.